Good morning, HCC. Come on, let's stand on our feet this morning. Let's put our hands together.
If you don't know, every first Wednesday of the month, we gather together at 7 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. So that will be this Wednesday. So first Wednesday this this Wednesday at 7 p.m. So we hope to see you guys there. But yeah, we're so excited you're here. So let's press back into the Holy Spirit as we dive back into worship.
Amen. He's worthy to be praised, isn't he? Father, we worship you right now in this moment. You're worthy of our praise and adoration. We love you, Jesus. Have your way in our lives. Yes, Jesus.
It was my cross you bore so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus, for you deserve praise. Worthy is your name, worthy is your name, oh Jesus, for you deserve.
With me now, my shame is gone,
and now my shame is gone. I stand amazed in your love, undeniable. Oh, your grace goes on and on, your grace goes on, and I will sing of your goodness forever.
Worthy is your name, oh Jesus.
worthy one more time. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. How worthy is your name. Worthy, worthy is your name. Oh, Jesus. You deserve the praise. How worthy is his name. How worthy is your name. How worthy is your name. How be exalted. How we love you, Jesus. Yes. Come on, all over this place right now. Let's just lift up some praise.
Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit. Yeah.
many believe he's a wonderful Savior? Come on, let him hear you, not me, let him hear you. I want us to go back into this song. I want to challenge you right here. I want you to worship beyond your circumstance. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what you're walking from in 2020 and walking into in 2021. But I want you to know in this moment, you can worship beyond your circumstance. And you can feel the presence of God in your life. So I want you to press beyond the now. Press beyond what you think your reality is and focus on Him. Can we worship like never before? Can we do that right now? Let's just take another moment. Come on. Come on, worship man, lead us. Come on right now.
Death could not hold.
It's not going to hold us.
You are victorious,
God. Today. Come on, raise your hand. Say, I'm going to believe Him. I'm going to trust Him in His Word. So this is the moment. We have people that are anxious, that are ready to agree with you today. Before I call for our altar workers, I want to pray for you right where you are. Maybe you don't feel comfortable coming forward and agreeing in prayer, but you agree right there in your seat. Then I believe that God can move wherever you might be. But after I pray for you and I say amen, if you'd like to come forward, we're going to take a few moments and we're going to ask you that would want prayer today. I don't care what it is that you're facing. Our God is greater. Amen. Our God is greater. And we want to trust Him with our lives, with our circumstance, with our situation. So if you have a need today of any kind, just slip up your hand. I want to pray for you right where you are. Come on, just slip up your hand and say, Pastor, please pray for me. Father God, Lord, you see these needs. You see them, God, right where they are. Lord, I ask that you meet them right where they are. You've come to seek and save. But on that cross and in the victory, God, of walking out of that tomb, Lord, you have healed us. You've redeemed us. You've made us whole, mind, body, and spirit. So we trust the complete work of your cross. And God, I ask that you move. And I look forward to the testimony of what you have done today in Jesus' name. Now, for those today, you say, you know what, I need a little more Jesus. I want someone to pray over my circumstance and situation. We have altar workers that are going to move right now, and they're going to stand up here. And as we go back into this song, softly, please don't hesitate. Please don't hesitate to trust God in this situation and come forward and allow us to pray with you right here, right now. Let's do this. Just sing these words again together softly.
This is my story.
Come on, if grace is a part of your story, sing these words.
Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Can we give some praise to Jesus right here in this moment? Thank you, Lord. And God, I just ask that the prayers that have come to you today, we have sent them upward. Because we're at the end of ourselves. What a great place to be at the end of all of our human capabilities and total trust and dependency in you. Jesus, move. Jesus, move. We stand in a gap of expectation and trusting you. We thank you and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. You may be seated. I'm moved a little bit today because, you know, our dear friend who went to be with Jesus in the last few weeks, Becky Carpenter, was over assigning and equipping our altar workers, and she would email and touch base, and one of our other elders' wives has now stepped into that gap and has been asking and partnering with people to minister in the altars, and she asked my son Clint, so it was his first opportunity to be an altar worker today and pray with people. And there's a particular story that I'm aware of coming into today where God has to do a miracle in a little baby's life by the name of Zachariah, and I brought the mother forward, and I wanted my son to be a part of a miracle. I wanted my son to experience what God's going to do and trust that with you and believe in prayer with you. We have to invite the next generation into who Jesus is. I don't know if you heard me say that or not. We have to do it. We have to do it. You know, if you look throughout the history of the Bible, you've seen all generations called to do the work of the ministry. Moses was really old. He was 80 when he finally said, "Okay, Lord, I'll do it." And God called him out of the desert and appointed him to deliver his people. And then we see David at probably 15 or 16. We see the mother of Jesus at 14, 15, 16. It is an assignment of God for the church to call that next generation and the generation ahead to say, "Hey, what is it that you're going to agree with God's word on and walk in those truths?" So I have great expectation for the prayers that are brought here. And please, if God moves in any capacity, we'd love to hear about it. Just let us know. Email us or call us and let us know, because we want to celebrate with you. There's no greater thing than to hear a testimony of how God moved in your life. We want to know about it, so don't ever hesitate to let us know. Ushers are going to move into their positions right now as we prepare our hearts to give. You know, I was pondering on this being a new year, a new season. 2020 is officially in hindsight, right? That's right, hindsight's 2020 now, finally, okay? And we're excited about that. I know not everybody had similar experiences. Some of you maybe look back at 2020 and go, it was amazing. Most of us aren't in that place. 2020 was a challenge. But as you now step into a calendar new year, I was telling in the first service that to my right, your left, is Blake Castater. It's the younger brother of Brandon. And Blake and I coached for 4 years together and at a local high school here in baseball. And one of the things we would always share with the kids is how you start something is normally going to affect the result of that, whether that's your swing and your approach to the ball, or as a pitcher, how you gather your mechanics depends on where that ball ends up. As you start a new year, what you choose to do, the Bible says that you will reap what you sow. It is as simple as farming. So as you're stepping into a new year, this particular area that the Holy Scripture speaks about, the idea of giving, being generous with the finance, you are in a position starting 21 to say, okay, what I do now is going to affect December of 21. My decisions and being obedient to Scripture is going to affect the next day. So as we walk into this new season, I want to challenge you. And I'm asking the Holy Spirit to speak to your heart in this area. That you would sow into fertile ground, knowing that there is a harvest, that there is a reaping that comes with that. So I challenge you going into this year. This scripture is my favorite scripture. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. This all in the context of that chapter talks about clothing and food and all the necessities, that you would have peace, that God's got you covered. But when I think of all, I think of all things. So I don't know what your all is, but there's a promise that if you'll seek first, and this is an area of your life to seek, that he will take care of us. And I'm trusting that for your life. So however you choose to give, you can give online, you can give with a check, cash, you can use a card. We want to be physical in our faith of giving. So I'm going to ask everybody to stand on their feet again. And I was telling them in the first service, maybe you don't have a job. Maybe you just lost your job. This has been a tough year. Then walk up to the bucket and give an air five to it in faith if you got to. Walk out and step in faith into 21 and trust God in this season. Amen. Amen. Let me bless you. Father God, I thank you. I thank you for the opportunity that we get to do this. We don't give to get, God. We give because our lives have been transformed and we want to see it happen in others. So we don't hesitate in our tithe to surrender that to you. Why? Because we're bringing something back that's already yours. And even in the offering, God, above and beyond. But we give, Lord, because we are trusting you with all aspects of our lives. May we start this year off right, not only with our time and being here, not only with our talent and our gifts that you've given us, and with our testimony as we sing songs of your grace and goodness, but Lord, of our treasure as well. We thank you and we praise you for your faithfulness and this opportunity to give. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you as you give. Thank you. Awesome. Well, Happy New Year, everybody. Say Happy New Year back. Yeah. Happy New Year back. That's being obedient. I love it. I either call that obedience or sarcasm. I don't know which one it is, but we're going to do something later in my sermon where I ask you to say your name, and somebody said their full name. So they were the last one talking after everybody said their first name. So I said, well, actually, you did what I asked. So it's all fun. I am so glad that you are here. Thank you for starting off the new year in the house of God with us. Appreciate you. We were packed in the first service. We actually had to turn people away in our kids' ministry because we have a cap on that so that we can safely be able to accommodate the next generation and share the love of Jesus with them. So I am so glad that you guys are here with us today. And there's a couple of things, a little bit of a commercial break here. I need to share a couple of things that are very important to us. First thing is starting tomorrow. Everybody say tomorrow. Now watch this enthusiasm go down. 7 a.m. Not bad. I really expected the second service people to not be excited about 7 a.m. But starting tomorrow, so it's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, every day at 7 a.m., we are going to pray together right here in the sanctuary. Starting the year off well. We're also going to have an opportunity for you to learn about fasting. That's something that's really exciting. Yeah. So I do the Daniel fast every year, and it's just so awesome. Headaches, agitation. My staff loves it when we have staff meeting right after fast starts. So I cover your prayers. But there's three things that are at the top of my food pyramid. Meat, bread, and sugar. Guess what you're not supposed to eat in the Daniel fast? Meat, bread, and sugar. Oh, yeah, it's going to be fun. So we're going to start off with we'll have information about how to do that. I encourage you, don't knock it till you try it. Fasting and prayer and the combination of that is a game changer for your life. So consider it, even if you can't be on property with us. You'll be able to go through our Facebook or through our website, and you can actually tune in from your house. If you go to work at like 7:30, you can let Juno join us, or you're able to get away at work, whatever it might be, from 7 to 8 a.m., we're going to be partnering with Church of the Highlands for their 21 days of prayer. You can follow all 21 days, but we will not be on property for all 21 days. We'll only be on property Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Now, Saturday kicks off something really cool. The 9th of January, one of our elders, Nicholas, will be leading our own prayer gathering at 10 a.m. That sounds better, doesn't it? 10 a.m. on Saturday, and it will be every Saturday from here on out. We'll be praying, interceding, and believing. Nicholas is going to come and teach on prayer for a few minutes and then release us to pray and then come to back for corporate prayer. So if you have any interest at all in growing in your faith and growing in your prayer life, this is going to be an incredible opportunity to kick this off for you. Next thing I want to communicate is both next step orientation, which is going to happen in February. Be mindful of that. If you're interested in growing with us in your faith and being a part of HCC, maybe you want to be a part of a dream team, which is volunteerism, or you just want to get to know more about us, we would love to get to know more about you. That is going to be February 17th on a Wednesday evening. Put that in your memory bank. I wanted to mention that to you now. The next thing is baptism, something that's very important to us. That's going to happen this month. If you're interested in any of this, please email nextsteps@hcconline. Again, that's nextsteps@hcconline, all right? Got it? .org. My commercial's over. I need a drink. Then I'll be back to you. If you haven't shared our service today, please do that. Get this message out. We go live for both services now. It's been interesting. We used to go only for the second service, and now we see a lot more views in our first service. So viewers online like to get up and get their day going and watch online, and we love it. All right, I am going to do a part two today. Last week, preached a sermon called Hold On and Let Go. What is it that God's speaking to you about from 2020 that you need to hold on to? What's he speaking about letting go of? And now we're going to do a part two, and I'm going to revisit Philippians chapter 3, 15 and 16, and we're going to dive a little deeper into these two verses. Before I do that, though, I want to speak to the book of Philippians and what Paul is trying to accomplish. This is what he's trying to do. We, all of us who are following Jesus, we should be moving forward each day in our knowledge, and understanding of our faith in Christ. We should be maturing in the faith, growing in grace, progressing in sanctification, which is the process of becoming increasingly like Jesus himself. As we keep him as the focus of our heart, for he is the head of the church, and we are his body. This is the theme all throughout the book of Philippians. And it is so important as Paul is trying to drive home this crucial understanding of maturing in the faith. So with that understanding, let's dive into Philippians chapter 3, 15 and 16. If you're ready, say ready. I'm going to read no matter what. So here we go. Therefore, let us. Who's us? It's us. Let us. Now it starts to filter a little bit, though. As many as are mature. He really gets a little bit specific here. Have this mind. So mature Christians have this mind, and I'll come back to what this mind is. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us be of the same mind. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, be present. Remove anything. Remove me today. Let people hear you as you speak through your word. Give them the ability, God, to apply it to their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible says that maturity comes from having this mind. What is this mind? Well, it's what I preached last week, and I will remind you of it. It is the willingness to examine self. Psalm 26 and 2, David said, examine my heart. Find out if there's anything wrong with me. A mature Christian can say those words and mean it. Not in a religious rhythm, say it, but is open to the Holy Spirit convicting us. Conviction is not just for the sinner, it's also for the saint. I rarely go through a day without some type of conviction and a reminder of a loving God saying, hey, come back over here. What should we hold on to? What should we let go of? The Bible is saying again in this chapter, forgetting those things that are behind. A mature Christian can't live in the past, but reaching forward to those things which are ahead. And then ultimately recognizing that the true prize is the call, the ability, the privilege that we have to partner with the God who created the universe. He wants to partner with us. It goes on to say in verse 15, God will reveal. I want to believe with you that in 2021, you're going to trust the Holy Spirit more. You're going to trust the Holy Spirit more. Not just with your life. And I'm going to read some scriptures about the Holy Spirit. Not just with your life, but this is going to release somebody in here with someone else's life that you really care about. There are some people you've been praying for, you've been preaching at, and you're exhausted. You're done. You've had to block them on Facebook. You've had to spend a little less time with them. I want to read some things to you that I hope will give you comfort, strength, and peace. John 14, 26 says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. There's another nugget here that I want to speak into your life. Get into the Word of God in 2021. You've been neglecting a life that is a life of abundance because you've lacked the discipline to get in His Word. Now, why is that important? Because the Holy Spirit can't bring something to remembrance that's not in your heart and in your mind. So you're going to be in a circumstance, you're going to be in a situation that dependence is necessary, and God wants to bring to your remembrance something. But if it's not there, you can't remember it. So how do we do that? We dig in. You know, I was thinking, it was silly. I didn't expect this. But there's this cool deal. I got to tell you a little bit of a story. Some of you may know this story, and it'll all connect. But last night, we watched a movie called Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. Who's ever watched that movie? Raise your hand. Yeah, it's a classic musical, okay? It's definitely cringe-worthy at sometimes, okay? Cringe means it's a little bit cheesy. Like you go, ugh. Like there's a couple songs I try to fast forward through. But 90% of it I really enjoy. And it's become a running joke. Me and my buddy Aaron Cook started it years ago because he was a tall, redheaded guy. So we would watch this movie. Don't tell anybody we did this, but if it's teenagers, we'd watch this movie. And then it became like this stamp of approval that if you were tight with us, you had to watch this movie. So now that's continued. So if anybody kind of gets connected to our family, you know, maybe a girlfriend or something like that, or a friend, you know, like, okay, you're ready now to sit down with the Mokes and watch Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. So that happened last night with a couple of my son's friends. Now, let me tell you, okay, my oldest son has got a wonderful, wonderful girlfriend for like a year and a half now. Her name is Alex. She's awesome. I love you. She's like a daughter. I tell her that all the time. And I'm enjoying this season of my life because one thing I've cherished is loving a woman, my wife. It's been the greatest joy of my life to surprise her, even though she doesn't like surprises. I like surprises, so I surprise her. Being her husband and doing the best that I can. And when I see my sons get a twinkle in their eye for somebody, I actually find joy in it because I hope that I have modeled something that they look forward to. Well, if you guys recall, there was a story that I shared with you guys about a young lady that I met on the beach. You guys remember this story? Raise your hand if you remember this story. Remember a couple of ladies yelled at me because I was being a creep according to them? And yeah, you remember all this story? Remember I told you that I told my son before she ever met this young lady, I said, you know one of the major roles of the father in the Bible was what? And he was like, what, Dad? I was like, find them a wife. And it was a big joke and we were laughing. So all this story culminates to this moment where this young lady, her name is Emma, and she's from Michigan, and we're having this conversation. Come to find out she's got cousins in Mason, and she loves to hunt, and she's all these cool things, and I'm having this conversation with her all while my son is having a panic attack in the ocean because he knows Dad is at work. And if you know my mom, she loves these things too, so she got involved. It was really getting a little hairy. So my wife has a tendency to try to protect her own kids from her own husband, their father. You guys have this dynamic anywhere in your family? Okay, like she's there to guard me to go too far. Well, listen, I'm led of the Lord, okay? Sometimes. Anyway, so all this happened. So long story short, this young lady by the name of Emma ends up meeting my son, Clint, right? So they hung out for 3 days, and she had to go back to Michigan. They've continued to have a conversation, and as a matter of fact, Emma is with us today. So if you'd please give a little warm welcome to our friend Emma. Emma, if you could stand up real quick. There's Emma right here. There's Emma. She lives in Reed, Michigan, and actually, we need to figure out a way to do this. She started skiing at 9 months old. I said that right. She has a little picture of her face at 9 months, okay? Now, I think I walked at 10 months. Let's put this in perspective. She's going down a slope skiing at 9 months. And now God might be opening some amazing doors for her to ski at the highest level, if you know what I mean. So it's really cool to see this journey. And she's a good friend of the family now, and we're connected. So thank God for the internet and FaceTime, even in long-distance relationships. I just think it's really cool that she's worshiping with us today. But I bring this full circle to say this. Last night, we're watching this movie, this staple for the Moak family. And there's this scene. My kids come to know I can find Jesus in everything. All right? Even Seven Brides and Seven Brothers. And oh, how Hollywood has changed. 1954. You don't know the movie. Long story short, a tall, handsome, redheaded man went into town to get him a wife. Now, mind you, a woman was observed a little more as a possession in this era, right? But he goes in to get meal and some food and to get him a wife, because that's how it worked, I guess. So he does. And this young lady by the name of Millie was milking a cow, and he went up and basically said, "It's a good day for a marrying. What do you think?" She's like, she goes, "I have to do my chores first." Literally said that, right? So they end up getting married, and he doesn't tell her that he's got six brothers, grown men, that have destroyed this country home that she's going to have to clean after and cook for. So she's hoodwinked. She's lied to. And she has this moment where after she fixes a meal and kind of pulls up her, you know, what do you call those? I guess britches. I don't know what it would be for her. But anyway, and just decides to go after it, and she's going to go ahead. Even though she's been lied to and misguided, she goes, "Okay, I'm going to do this." She finally fixes a meal, and they show up and destroy the kitchen. She gets mad. She calls them pigs. She flips the table, and she runs out crying. And you know what she does? She goes to her bedroom, and she opens up the Bible. In the moment where she was at the end of herself, she turns to the Lord. And in that moment of simplicity where Hollywood was actually exalting the Word of God, I go, am I there? Like when I am in a moment where things didn't turn out like I thought, where things aren't what I wanted, is my immediate response to rest in Him? She was at the wit's end, and she went to a story and read it out loud audibly, and you saw this transition where I can make it now. Is that your story? Is that my story? Because that's what we're called to do in the Word of God and partnering, because it wrote the Holy Scriptures, needs to be there. John 16 and 13 says, "However, when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth. For He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He will speak. And He will tell you things to come." Man, what kind of peace you can have in the Holy Spirit. Think about all the uncertainties that we faced in 2020. It seemed like we didn't know what was going to happen the next day. But for those that could find peace in the One who knew what tomorrow holds, what a difference that made. Continuing in the Scriptures, it says, "already attained." This word "attained" is used three different times. It's used in verse 12, it's used in 13, and it's used in 16. And this word means to arrive. Now, not in the arrogance of some people, "I've arrived, worship me." But more in the fact that I was once here and now I am here. Is there something that God might be able to reveal in your life where you say, "Hey, I was here, but God, now You've brought me to this place and I have arrived. I have attained this thing." I began to ponder for my own self what that thing might be. Now, I'm going to be cautious in how I say this because I have not fully arrived. But what I'm trusting for my journey is I'm not going to allow the petty stuff to affect me as much. Notice how I said that. I'm not going to stand here in arrogance and say, "Petty stuff is never going to bother me again in the name of Jesus," because I just know that's not the truth. We're all guilty of sand in the shoes being the thing that's the greatest irritant. But when I think about it for my own life, I want to be able to move into 21, not allowing small things to throw me off course of what God is asking of me. I want the ability to stay the course and not let the petty stuff drive me. This is a word right here, 2 Timothy 2, 23, 24, and 25. Because when it comes to observing things that people say, I try to stay away from responding, even though I know I could. Because I know it just gets me in a mode and in an attitude and in a place that I really don't want to go. So what I end up doing is I end up complaining to my wife about it. Is anybody else like that? Like, you don't do the keyboard warrior thing, but you see something you didn't like, and there's somebody you can talk to about it. That poor person. Pray for that other person. For us extroverts, you introverts that like to, are willing to listen, God bless your heart. Look what 2 Timothy 2, 23, 24, and 25 says, "But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes." Can we do that in 21? Anybody agree that'd be a really good idea? knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, be patient, in humility, correcting those who are in opposition. If God perhaps will grant them repentance so that they will know the truth. Again, somebody's about to be released here because some of you are beating your head against the wall because you're trying to declare a truth to an unrepented heart. It's a waste of your breath. Pray for them. Declare truth and grace with patience and gentleness. But the conviction of the Holy Spirit must sovereignly hit that person, and they must repent in order to have the mindset that you have. And that's a truth somebody needs to hear today. Because you're putting a lot of time and energy into an unrepented heart that is just not going to see the cross than anything other than foolishness. Because that's what the Bible says. What you found to be a light that's went off, they see as foolishness. And it requires a God to convict. They must repent. Look, it says, if God perhaps will grant them repentance so that they may know the truth. I think it would be important going into 21 that we don't focus too much on what we don't know. I'm not saying not to grow in knowledge. I'm not saying not to get an education. But a lot of us put a lot of attention on talking about stuff that we don't know nothing about. But what do you know? Don't let the things that you don't know fog up the things that you do know that you're supposed to do. I saw so many people engage in conversations that they had no reason being in. And it broke relationships. It hurt them. It affected their faith. And I thought, man, that was just so unfortunate. You know, I saw many times people allowing the strife and the stuff that's happening outside their home, outside their family, and outside their church family come into their own hearts. Whether it was political, whether it was racial, socioeconomic, sports, I don't know, all kinds of silly stuff. But there were a lot of things that we allowed to affect us because we didn't make the main thing the main thing. And it was heartbreaking. I know it was heartbreaking for God. I know it was for me in many ways. And we're going to talk about unity in a moment. Philippians chapter 1, so staying in the same lane of what I'm talking about in chapter 3. Paul speaks and he says, one spirit and one mind, and no way be terrified by your adversaries. One of the greatest adversaries, one of the greatest enemies in 2020 was fear. It was rampant. It has affected us and continues to affect us. I'm not talking about not using wisdom. I think wisdom's important. But fear drove the context of our nation, of our churches, of our country, and of our lives. It caused so much hatred and division. It still does even today. But Philippians 1 is saying, one spirit, one mind, in no way be terrified by your adversaries. And I believe that fear was a major contributor. We allowed a lot of things outside the walls to affect us on the inside. Even in our own, for the walls of our body, within ourselves. So I'm believing for greater faith in 21. Greater wisdom in 21. But not let fear drive us. Because there is no fear in love. There is no fear when it comes to faith. So many relationships were damaged in 2020. Some of you are still picking up the pieces. It's heartbreaking. But there's something that's being said here that we need to put some attention to. It says very clearly that we are to have, in the beginning, it says, have this mind, And then it ends and says, let us walk by the same rule and let us be of the same mind. Everybody say that with me. Say, same mind. Same mind is referring to a unified thought. I want to say this as a warning to this house. I want you to hear me. If there's one thing that I'm asking you to please be attentive to and be on guard, is disunity. As a matter of fact, for those who have joined this church in membership, if you haven't, I'd love for you to consider it. But when you actually signed off on a covenant with us, one of the pillars was you would protect the unity of this church. Because I can promise you one thing the enemy wants is for us to be divided. Because divided we fall, but unified we will survive. And not just survive, we'll thrive. So when Paul is talking to the church in Philippi, he is saying, be of the same mind, because he knows the power behind this. So if there's people speaking against us, don't be in relationship with that. Here's the thing I can promise you. I will never ask you to sin. And because of leadership and because of filtering processes, we will do our best always to ask you to do something that's biblical. That's our call. That's what we're supposed to do. So if that is the case, I am asking you to trust us. But even greater than that, trust him. Because this is his church. We are his body. And as we step into this new season, you know, I was talking in the first service, I said, there's a term, and we were having an elders meeting yesterday, and I said, you know, you can take, the classic phrase is, you can take a horse to the water, but you can't make him drink, right? You've heard that phrase before. I feel like as a pastor, it's even hard to get people to the water. Let's not even talk about whether they'll drink or not. I'm not trying to be depressing. I'm just bringing reality to you. Before the COVID season hit, you were lucky to get people on property twice a month. That's just where we're at. Now they're telling us that only a third of the church is going to stay. Okay, so let's talk about that for a second. A third will actually be with us. A lot of people are saying, this is your church, move forward. It hurts my heart. I don't like that. I don't like that at all. I'm believing that when this season is over, people are going to come back to the physical house. We've got people joining online, and that moves me. They've stayed faithful, and I appreciate that. Thank God for that option. What I'm trying to tell you is this, as we move forward going into this season and God has called us to know, share together Jesus, it's going to require that time, which is our biggest currency really, that we use it wisely. I'm concerned about what the church looks like in 10 years. HCC, I told the elders this, I'm being very transparent with you. A lot of people, other pastors tell me, Curtis, you've seen too much, whatever. I think one of the values to this house is authenticity. I'm concerned about what this church looks like in 10 years because there's not enough time to get in discipleship together. I'm being very true. Say, it's okay, Pastor. Tell me. I need you to tell me it's okay to be transparent here because I got to be. The reason this church has been so amazing is because people have sat together and went through the scriptures together. It's not happening. The only discipleship the majority of this church is getting is from my mouth on Sunday, and that's a problem. So I say that in all love, but we're going to figure it out, praise God. We're going to figure it out. But as we move into this new season, we know the power of the Word. We know the power of the Spirit. And we know how crucial it is for the church. We don't want just to have a church in 10 years. We want to have a Spirit-filled, power-filled church that looks like Jesus. So just to gather for the sake of gathering is not the plan. It's what we understand it to be according to His Scriptures. So in that, if that's the passion, that's the desire, we are asking, I'm asking that as I may roll out some things over the next few weeks, trust us. And if you're able to show up, show up. If you're able to tune in online, tune in online. If you're able to be a part of a chat, if we have to move some groups to chats, because that's the most, we will do it, bless God. We'll do it. We will make whatever needs to happen, happen. So I'm just asking you that in the unity, that if you start hearing, well, why are they doing it that way? Or what's going on? Shut it down. Trust God. Trust and be a part of what God is doing. I want to give you a very small, but I think a powerful illustration. Because this will make or break a church. If it's your agenda, if it's your ideas that are most important, there will be a limited amount of growth and there'll be a lot of disunity, and it will sound a little bit about what you're about to do right now. But if we'll come around and unify ourselves in Christ, it will sound a lot different. I'm going to count down from three, and I want you with some passion to say your first name only. Can you do that for me? I want you to say your name. Can you do that? Don't say your neighbor's name. And if you don't know your own name, I'm sorry, I don't understand. Okay? So here we go. 3, 2, 1. That sounded beautiful, didn't it? We'll give you another try. Ready? 3, 2, 1. That was very confusing. I honestly didn't hear one name, but about 150 people just said their names, and I don't know what you just said. Okay? Sounds like a thriving situation, right? Now we're going to try something else. I want everybody to say Jesus after I get to one. 3, 2, 1.
Jesus.
That felt powerful. That felt unified. That felt like something. And it was a clear message. It's a simple illustration, but it's powerful. We each have our own journey, and I'm praying that God, you have a personal revival this year. That faith will rise. But as we come together as a local body, that we'll trust the process, that we'll trust the movement of what God is doing, because God desires to move. God desires to grow his house. So I ask you to consider it. I ask you to pray about it and join us. So in 2021, may you hold on to what you need to hold on to. May you let go of what you need to let go of. I don't know about you, but I'm not going back. Let us strive for unity. I'm going to tell you, you're going to have to strive for it. You're going to have to work for it. You have an enemy that doesn't want you to do that. It's real easy to just dive into selfishness. The enemy wants to tear us apart. We should be moving forward each day in our knowledge and understanding of our faith in Christ. That's a personal response and responsibility of my personal walk. But then there's a corporate commitment as well. We should be maturing in the faith, growing in grace, progressing in a sanctification process that looks more like Jesus every day. We need to keep him as the focus of our heart, for we must be reminded today that he is the head of this church and we are his body. Here's the deal. I know many of you were knocked down in 2020. I get it. But my question is, will you stay there? I already feel the apathy. I feel the excuse. I mean, if anything's going on, just blame COVID. Let's just be honest. Is that not what we're doing? So we can all easily fall into this, well, it's just the way it is. It is what it is. But I don't want to stay there. I got to be honest with you. We cannot stay there. When we serve a God who rose from the grave, can I tell you something? We cannot stay in the tomb of 2020. Stand with me. Stand with me. Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this opportunity to dive into your word. For your word gives life. Your word strengthens us. It convicts us. It draws us close to your heart. For we can know your thoughts, God. We can know your intentions for us. Holy Spirit, guide us, mold us, and shape us. I want to take this opportunity just right where we are and allow this word that was given today just to absorb our hearts. So let's take just the next few moments and let's worship together. Let's be vulnerable in this moment.
You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name.
Let's reflect.
Oh, Jesus. You deserve praise. Oh, worthy is your name. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. And be exalted now in the heavens as your glory.
Where you're at, I have a question to ask. If there's anybody here, whether online or in this service right now, you don't know Jesus, this is the greatest decision that you could ever make. Start the year off right. To trust Him with your life. This is a God-ordained moment. Don't think about lunch. Don't think about a game. Don't think about anything other than your eternal salvation. Right here, right now. This is the day of salvation. Choose wisely. So with nobody looking around, you say, Pastor Curtis, I want to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior today. I'm not worried about tomorrow. I'm not reflecting on the past mistakes. I want to receive Him right now. Would you just raise your hand and say, that's me. I want to receive Jesus right now. Raise your hand. Don't let this moment pass you by. Don't worry about what your neighbor's thinking, the person next to you. Slip up your hand and say, remember me in this prayer. I want to receive Jesus. Awesome. Can we say this together? Say, dear God, through your Son Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Be my Savior and be my Lord. I repent of my sin. I believe you died on the cross for me. You rose again for me. You took my sin upon yourself. Give me a new identity in you. In Jesus' name. There's another prayer that I want to do, but if you just received Jesus, we want to know about it. Text HCC Faith, all caps, to 94000. I'll follow up with you personally this week, and we'll get you on a track to trusting the Lord in your walk with Him. Now I want to talk to everybody. If you've been challenged today by this word and you need the Holy Spirit to help you, you can't do this in your flesh, but you're going to ask the Holy Spirit to help you walk this out in your life. Would you just lift up your hand? I'm going to pray for you. Is there anybody here? Praise God. Let me pray for you. Father God, again through your Son Jesus, oh Holy Spirit, Lord, just give us the strength, God, to be able to walk out what has been spoken today. Help us, Lord, to be able to hold on to what we need to hold on to let go of what we need to let go of. Lord, to have a hunger for your word. To trust you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, to trust you with my circumstance, with my life, with others in my life. And help me, God, if I'm called to this house, help me to protect the unity of this house as we collectively together are going to fulfill the purposes for this house. Help us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now put your hands up like so. I want to bless you before you go. Thank you for starting your year off with us. God bless you. I want to remind you again, Wednesday, 7 o'clock, right here, we're going to have service midweek. It's a great midweek. Pick you up. We'd love to have you here, okay? Father God, again, through your Son Jesus, by the power of your Spirit, thank you for this day in which you have made, and we have rejoiced, and we are glad in it. Lord, help us to operate from favor, God. Help us to never try to perform for it. Thank you for your salvation. Thank you, Lord, that we can look more and more like you. Mature us, God. Go before us, Lord. Protect us and keep us safe. Lord, I pray blessing upon every household, every individual, every person, God. Meet them where they are. And God, I thank you that in Jesus we get to do these three things. We get to know, share together. Amen and amen. God bless you and Happy New Year.